The original ending to The Descent felt like a colossal punch to the gut. The main antagonist is forced to endure some absolutely horrific circumstances, including watching her friends die, mercy killing another one of her friends, and brutally maiming another who had an affair with her husband just so she's granted a chance at freedom. Once those women head down into those caves, with anybody on the surface completely unaware of their location, it's game over for them. And when you make it to the end of this absolute roller coaster of tension, the movie puts its middle finger directly into your face and laughs at you as you witness Sarah waking up still inside the cave with absolutely nowhere to go after believing that she'd managed to be the lone survivor. So what does The Descent 2 go and do with that? Being directed by John Harris, an editor for the original movie, it entirely retcons Neil Marshall's original ending and ends up going with the cut-down American ending that conveniently cuts out the part where Sarah wakes up back in the cave. Because I guess if the first entry is a great financial success, then obviously you want to create a second in the form of a license to print money. Oh wait. Well, it's awfully convenient that there just happened to be a cut-down ending, because The Descent 2 begins with Sarah running up to this tow truck driver's car, absolutely covered in blood, kind of forgetting the fact that she had her own car in the original. Two, actually. She's taken to a hospital and sedated, where the local sheriff comes along to pay her a visit. But it's pretty clear from the outset that the sheriff has already made up his mind about Sarah. She went into those caves with her friends, and came out alone covered in blood. Therefore, she single-handedly murdered her entire group of friends. Case closed, lads. That was easy. Despite being told that she's been sedated and that she has no memory of the previous 2 days, the sheriff and Officer Rios begin to ask her clearly awake and definitely not sedated Sarah questions, and it's obviously clear that due to the traumatic events that she managed to survive, her mind has begun to mentally block out the events of the previous few days, and perhaps even longer than that actually, with Sarah being seemingly unaware that her own daughter has passed away, with that happening more than a year ago at this point. So what does the sheriff do after a police officer, the tow truck driver, and a tracking dog find where they think Sarah emerged from? Well, he has this clearly injured and mentally unwell woman, suffering from God knows what psychological and physical injuries, discharged from the hospital, and taken right back to the very caves that she just escaped from. Now, I'm no police officer, but I'm pretty sure what you'd call that right there is an absolutely terrible idea and an incredible lack of judgment for someone whose job it is to protect. We learn that there's actually a rescue attempt currently underway, but the only problem being is that it's at the cave that Juno told everybody that they were heading to, before actually taking the group of women somewhere entirely different so they could be the ones to discover it. With that actually also serving as somewhat of a way to her relieve some of her guilt, due to believing that if they're the ones to discover it, and that they name it after Sarah, then that would somehow make up for the fact that she had an affair with Sarah's husband. So the moral of the story is, don't cheat, otherwise your entire group of friends will be horrifically cannibalized. The rescuers are Dan, the most experienced one of the group, and Cass and Greg, who seem to have been trained by Dan over the years. And when it comes to information about their characters, or a semblance of any personality, well, there isn't any. That is, unless you count Greg's tendency to make inappropriate jokes as a fleshed-out character. They all meet at the entrance to the old mineshaft, which isn't actually where Sarah escaped from in the original movie, as in her hallucination, which I guess actually isn't a hallucination anymore, we see her clambering her way out of the cave and emerging into the outside world through a small hole in the ground. The tow truck driver, who for some reason is still here, explains to the group that his grandfather used to work in these mines, and one day way back when, the miners broke through into another large cave system, and after being sent through to explore it, he never came back. And despite clearly being told by a medical professional that Sarah has no memory of the last few days, the sheriff decides to take it upon himself to make Sarah go down there with him, as she's the only one who would potentially know their way around this uncharted cave system. Except she doesn't. This is the same woman who doesn't even remember that her own daughter has passed away, discharging someone from a hospital who is clearly mentally and physically unwell, essentially accusing them of murdering their group of friends, and forcing them down into an uncharted cave system, gives the term gross negligence a run for its money. But as they're going down, Officer Rios takes it upon herself to be somewhat of a guardian figure for Sarah. The sheriff's this large, imposing force, who already has made his mind up about this woman, where Rios sees her for what she actually is, a scared, damaged woman who absolutely should not be in this situation. And despite Sarah's mind having no recollection of the last few days, it seems that her body does. As while they're descending down into the old abandoned mines, she's absolutely petrified, but doesn't know why. They make their way through the old mine system, and eventually to the blocked off passageway to the neighboring cave. And little bits of what's taken place down here start to sporadically come back to Sarah, as she believes that she spots one of the cave creatures, but it actually just turns out to be a rather deceptive calcium deposit that apparently likes to cosplay as the human form. Cass begins using a device to detect faint noises off in the distance, and after thinking that she can hear something or someone, they follow the direction that it's coming from, and they end up stumbling across the incredibly mangled remains of Becca's corpse. As it turns out, these creatures are actually rather wasteful when it comes to their food, with them only having a little bit of a nibble on her insides. The clearly deceased body begins to twitch and move on its own, before suddenly, a rat emerges from the inside of Becca's mouth, before scurrying away from the group, truly freaking out everybody in the process. And could you just imagine the sheer terror of fighting for your life and being actually able to escape such a place, to just unknowingly stroll right back into it and back into the exact same scenario that you just fled from? As they push onwards to search for the rest of the missing women, they're crawling through a narrow space when suddenly the tight feeling of claustrophobia triggers Sarah's horrific and traumatic memories to return, causing her to kick the sheriff in the face and to make a run for it. Well, a crawl for it. She punches Rios and Greg in the face, as if they're somehow responsible for the eating of her friends, and disappears off into the darkness of the cave system. She's reverted into the survival mode that she was forced into in the previous movie, the same state that ensured that she survived that movie, the only reason that she was able to go toe-to-toe with multiple creatures and survive, and the only reason that she was able to do something as cold as injure Juno to ensure her own survival. After taking Greg's thermal camera and running off after Sarah, alone in this labyrinthine cave structure with no radio, despite clearly being told by Dan earlier that taking a gun down into an underground cave system is an absolutely terrible idea and would all but certainly cause a cave-in killing absolutely everybody, the sheriff pulls back the hammer on his gun, because I guess he just plans to execute Sarah now, and is knocked unconscious by one of the creatures, fires a shot off, and exactly as Dan stated, causes a cave collapse, almost killing the entire group of rescuers in the process. Which now means the group of rescuers are in the exact same position that the women were in the original movie. They're trapped inside and have no choice but to push onwards. Everyone but Cass managed to make it out of the room with no injury, but Cass has miraculously found herself still alive, as if any of the rocks landed a few inches in any other direction, it would have certainly meant death. She might be alive, but she's trapped between a handful of incredibly unstable rocks that could easily shift at any moment, turning her into a Cass pancake. And after realizing that there's no way that they're going to get through the rocks to her, using their radios, the rest of the group let her know that they're going to have to find another way around to her, meaning that once they leave, then so will their signal, leaving Cass alone in this dark, unfamiliar prison with absolutely nowhere to go and no one for company. Well, that's not entirely true, as while she's having trouble getting her torch to work, for a split second we see that she does in fact have company, and they've come over for dinner. Dan, Rios, and Greg stumble upon one of the creature's many feeding pits that they seem to have scattered all over their den, and that's where they find the camcorder used by the women in the previous movie. As Sarah hides, listening in nearby, the group play back the footage to see the final few hours of the women's lives, as they prepare for the trip and ultimately make the descent down into the cave, with them having absolutely no idea what they're walking right into and what's waiting down here for them. Suddenly it cuts to another moment, the moment where they use the infrared to see. It's the exact moment that they're attacked for the first time, before themselves turning to be given the exact same introduction that the women got, as there's a creature standing right there. Sarah, with most of her memory regained, obviously understands how these creatures operate. She sits there in silence, looking on, as she can see a creature slowly making its way to Rios, as she's calling out to the others who have fled. But unlike how she left Juno for dead to save her own life, perhaps because Rios had previously shown her compassion and care, she sneaks up behind Rios and covers her mouth just as the creature pounces on Dan, biting off his fingers and burying its teeth into his neck. They sit there in complete silence, as Rios is absolutely horrified to watch this man die, and Sarah more than likely used to it at this point, with no other option but to sit tight and remain silent, absolutely helpless to save Dan. And as they watch the creature drag its prey away, not only is it taking Dan's corpse away, but also the most experienced person in this cave. If they had a shot at getting out of here, it was because of Dan. Emphasis on was. Cass reaches out her hand into the opening of the rocks into the unknown, and after getting cave-dwelling creature drool all over her hand, she comes face to face with one of them as it begins circling her and trying to dig its way in. Claustrophobic and cramped, with no other choice as this creature is going to get to her, she removes all of her gear and begins forcing her way through a tiny, unstable gap above her head that could easily crush her to death at any moment, or pin her in place for the creature to come and take. And as it does grab her legs and feet, she manages to pull herself out of there just in the nick of time, and knock the boulder down to crush the creature's skull. She runs off to find Greg, and the sheriff finds Dan. Or should I say, Dan finds the sheriff, as he literally just falls from the ceiling and straight onto him for some reason. Because I guess the creatures just like to pin up their victims on the wall for decorative purposes. Unaware of the creature's reliance on sound, Cass and Greg unknowingly lead one of them directly towards them, but have the quick thinking and the rock-climbing abilities to climb back to back to hide above the creature. That is, until the sheriff, who for some reason has this compulsion to constantly try and kill all of the people helping him, decides to call out to them on the radio, alerting the creature to their exact location, so they're forced to climb higher and to throw the radio as a distraction. And as they're making a run for it, Cass and Greg then come across Sam still dangling corpse, as she hangs there lifeless, in the exact same spot that she died in, because these creatures really aren't ones for cleaning up. And rather luckily for the pair, she's halfway across the sheer drop, meaning that they can use her body to get across. But rather unluckily for the pair, as Cass makes the jump, so does a female creature, as Greg's attacked by another. And after being given the forbidden hickey by one of the creatures, Greg grabs a drill to give the creature an impromptu lobotomy, and using his last dying breath, he leaps onto the creature and plummets with it to the depths below, ensuring that Cass has actually got a chance at survival. Before Cass immediately squanders the chance at survival by screaming out to Greg, alerting a creature to her presence, and serving herself up as a rather easy and convenient meal for it, making Greg a hero for all but 5 seconds. Up until now, the movie hasn't really used its cramped, subterranean setting to its advantage quite how the original movie had done, by seriously playing into the fears of claustrophobia and what might be lurking just out of sight in the dark. So the film immediately cranks it up to 11 by having Rios and Sarah descend into a small pool, unable to see where it goes, and if there's actually a way out of it at the end. And along the way, Rios begins to panic as she makes it from one pocket of air to the next, making the audience think that an oncoming panic attack would surely mean her drowning to death. But luckily for her, Sarah's able to come back and comfort her in the exact same way that Rios once did for her as they were descending down into the mines together. The sheriff's confronted by one of the creatures and just casually punches it in the face, before then falling onto his back, where he's seemingly about to meet his demise. And right before this creature is able to plunge its fangs into him, something or someone violently attacks the creature from behind, repeatedly slamming a pick into it until it's dead. It's Juno, who is somehow still alive, despite being alone with a broken leg against a literal army of the creatures who have proven to be extremely dangerous on their own. Never mind when there's an entire pack of them homing their way directly in on you. It appears that she's unlocked the incredibly rare item known as plot armor. Meaning that yes, it was a hallucination of Sarah seeing her ghost at the end of the original movie. I would say, of course it wasn't real Sarah seeing a ghost of her, how silly is that? But then again, Juno somehow single-handedly managed to wipe out an entire pack of them on her own, so how silly is that? As Sarah and Rios are forcing their bodies through a long narrow shaft in the rocks, Sarah realizes that they're not alone in this corridor, as she spots a creature down the other end, just hanging out and chilling. And in between Sarah and the creature is a small passageway that a mouse emerges from. And with Rios unaware of what lays ahead of them, and Sarah unable to tell her without alerting the creature, the mouse walks right past Sarah and straight up to Rios, causing her to scream out in a panic, alerting the creature directly towards them. So with nowhere to go but forwards, Sarah begins to crawl as fast as she can, beelining it towards the hole that the rat came from, and falls down it just in the nick of time, leaving Rios face to face with this creature. And just as you think it's the end for her, Sarah quickly burns its face with a flare, before the pair drop into a pool of rather questionable looking liquid, quickly followed by the creature. And in a frantic fight for survival, Sarah begins punching the creature with a metal piece of equipment, before it then submerges itself, and then pounces onto her, pinning her against the wall. So thinking quickly, Rios pulls out her hairpin, and thrusts it into the creature's neck, killing it. Who knew that women were walking around with mini daggers in their hair? And after climbing out of the questionably colored pool of water, Sarah uses the infrared camera that was somehow able to withstand bathing in poop water in order to see her surroundings, before almost directly walking straight into Juno, followed by Juno erupting into an attack. And as she has Sarah on the ground, pick in hand, ready to enact her revenge, she decides to let her live. I screwed your husband, you stabbed me in the leg, bygones be bygones. The sheriff, in his absolute infinite wisdom, decides to handcuff Sarah to himself because easy mobility clearly isn't something that's required down here, which very quickly proves to be the end of him, as when they come across a bridge that's constructed of loose collapsed rocks, everybody crosses it one at a time safely, except the sheriff and Sarah. And just as they're about to safely make it across, the rocks give way, causing the sheriff to drop and dangle over the edge, with nothing but Sarah's wrists to hold his entire body weight. With all of the noise and the commotion that's caused, the creatures have been alerted and have begun to approach their position, leaving the women with no other choice but to take Juno's pick and repeatedly swing it into the sheriff's arm until eventually it breaks off due to the weight tugging on it, sending him and the creatures to the depths below. The women then find the exit that the creatures use to hunt wildlife on the surface and begin to slowly make their way past a couple of feasting creatures. But as they're doing so, an incredibly large creature enters from above and is immediately alerted to their presence as a somehow still alive Greg reaches out and grabs Juno. Because the first movie had someone survive a serious neck wound for way longer than they really should have, so this one needs one too. The only difference being is that in the original, is that Beth, still somehow being alive, served as an important plot device for Sarah to find out that Juno did this to her and that she left her here. But in this one, it only exists to simply alert the creatures before Greg immediately keels over and dies on the spot before he can actually take any responsibility for it. Nice one, Greg. The women are able to deal with the smaller creatures without too much of an issue, but no matter what, the large creature just simply won't go down. Sarah and Rios actually find themselves with an opportunity to flee, as the big creature is currently distracted, throwing Juno around like a ragdoll, but Sarah's already left her for dead once, and chooses to instead save her. She jumps onto the back of it, and uses the still attached handcuffs to hold the creature's mouth open, but in the struggle, the creature tears open Juno's insides, causing her to fall to the ground as the light begins to leave her eyes. But just as you think that it's all over for her, she shoots back up and bites a chunk out of the creature's neck, giving Sarah the opportunity to plant the pick into the temple of the large creature, killing it instantly. Juno dies in Sarah's arms, as Rios begs her to leave with her, but by the time they both turn around, it's too late. The entire family has shown up. So in a rather selfless act, in a complete opposite to what she did to Juno in the original movie, to give Rios the opportunity to live and see her daughter once again, Sarah begins to scream at the top of her lungs, causing all of them to run directly towards her, and Rios makes a run for it. And in a recreation, or somewhat of a homage to the original movie, Rios begins to clamber her way up the cave in an almost identical shot to the original, before being able to break through the foliage above and safely onto the surface. But just as she's about to call the police, she's knocked unconscious by the very same tow truck driver who saved Sarah in the beginning and helped the rescue team find the mineshaft. He takes her right back to the hole, and the movie ends with a creature pouncing out to take her right back down. Why, you ask? Why would this man do such a thing? Well, who knows, because this was the final entry in the series, and it didn't perform well enough to warrant another entry. So that means we're left with a confusing, unfinished story, where we can only speculate the truth of what happened. There's a myriad of different fan theories out there, like he wants to keep the creatures fed so they don't wander into nearby towns, or perhaps his grandfather didn't go down there and die, but instead went down there and became one of the first generations of these creatures. But that directly contradicts the original movie, with them being prehistoric humans who decided to live underground. But all of that aside, what I really want to know is if he wants people to be killed and eaten by these creatures, then why did he save Sarah in the opening and alert the authorities? He's clearly trying to be sneaky about it, so why would he take the risk of having more people find out? But oh well, that's an answer that will more than likely never be answered, as compared to the success of the original Descent, The Descent 2 completely flopped, dooming the franchise to lay dormant forever. The first movie was an excellent piece of horror media. Sure, at times I did think that it relied a little too hard on jump scares where it didn't actually need to, but in the most part, it excelled in doing in what it set out to do. That being, creating a claustrophobic nightmare that really played with the idea of being trapped in an unfamiliar place with no way to get out. But this one, while not being the worst sequel that I've ever come across, feels more like it exists purely to profit off the success of the original movie, and not because it's a really awesome idea for a terrifying horror movie. So before we wrap things up, I'd like to just give a shout out to my clothing brand, Morbid Minds. If you like any of the things you see on screen right now, make sure you go to morbidminds.co.uk to cop yourself a cool t-shirt or hoodie, and make sure to stay tuned because we'll have other clothing drops coming in the near future. Also, make sure to follow me on Twitter if you're down in the description, and a big thank you to my patrons. Thank you to Dom, Hunters263, Rebecca Pitts, A Dandy in Space, Martin Brannan, Natasha Twyman, Rin and Whiskey, Jarrett C. Bees, Pascal Mathis, Fighting the Pirates, Richard McGowan III, Macy J., Reese Harford, Horatio, Raby Patterson, Chris, Michelle, Newcomb, Dennis, Wade Knott, Ike, Mr. J2, Ashley L. Wintz, Austin Wypert, Christopher Butsky, Joshua Torres, Axon Imari, Billy Kyle, and Remy. Thank you so much to my patrons, and thank you to everyone else for watching.